Hi, it's Steve. Welcome to my day six video of this 30 days of video series and also water fasting at the same time. So I've gone more than 5 days without food. It's coming up on 2 PM on day six, and I'll give you a quick update on the fasting first. Today, I think, has been the best day of the fast so far. I was a little bit sluggish early in the morning, but wow, the afternoon has like been great. I've been feeling just happy, high energy, euphoria, great mental clarity. So that's been nice because I've definitely, you know, had much lower energy the past few days. Yesterday afternoon, I went for a walk outside for about 30 minutes or so. That was nice. It was nice to finally get outside and get some sunshine because I'm not exercising, you know, no cardio or anything else during this water fasting period, because that's just going to break down muscle if I do that. But it's nice, you know, now and then to just get out and go for a walk. The problem is I can't predict what my energy is going to be like. So when I feel like a surge of energy, I want to go and just get some more movement in. And I felt a little bit of a surge yesterday afternoon. So I walked about 30 minutes outside. After that, I was starting to feel pretty tired. Like I could feel my leg muscles getting a bit, you know, fatigued. I mean, normally I can go for a 2-3 hour walk, no problem, when I'm not fasting. And I love long walks, but you know, just it's kind of funny how you have to really lower your standards when you're on a fast for what you're capable of doing, because you'll get tired pretty quick. You just don't have that much energy. Today, I feel like I could probably go for an hour walk, no problem. But sometimes, you know, it's pretty variable. So when I go out for a walk, when I'm fasting, I stay close to home the whole time, or I stay close to my car if I'm going somewhere else. And that way I'm playing it safe. So if I start feeling dizzy or faint or just weak or anything like that, I'm only a few minutes away from my car and I can get back to it pretty quickly, or a few minutes away from my house and I can get back to it quickly. So, you know, especially since I'm doing this fast unsupervised, I'm playing it safe. You know, I don't recommend this to other people to do this unsupervised unless you really know what you're doing. I've spent a lot of time researching fasting, talking to people who've done fasts, and, you know, gathering a lot of information about it. And I felt like I could do it. And also, I tend to like taking some risks here and there. But I'm risking, you know, potentially myself. And, you know, I don't want you to take that kind of risk too unless you really have, you know, researched it thoroughly and you really know what you're doing. Because there can be definitely some health risks from long-term fasting if you're not careful. What do I want to talk about today? So the topic I wanted to discuss with you today is about elegant solutions to problems. When you have problems to solve in your life, you know, there's a lot of different ways to solve them. And I think the ideal that I've found that I love to strive for is to find a solution that looks elegant. And this is something I learned back when I was in high school, when I was, you know, taking math classes. And I was a really good student in math. I'd say the best in my class. I don't think anybody who was in my class with me would disagree. And what I learned is that, you know, for many classes of math problems that we got assigned for homework, there was often more than one way to solve them. We could use the standard textbook solution that we were learning in the books, or we could come up with some other creative solution. And occasionally I'd get assigned a math problem and then I'd solve it some other way that I thought was better than the book solution. So maybe the book solution had 15 steps and I was able to do it in 7 or 8 steps. And sometimes I would get like extra praise or reward, you know, rewarded like emotionally by the teacher if I came up with a creative solution. So that encouraged me to do more of that. And I had some really good math teachers in high school, especially in the last couple of years, who encouraged me, you know, to stretch myself a lot. They would sometimes give me, actually quite often, they would give me extra assignments outside of class and encourage me to do things. And I ended up being president of the math club and learning all kinds of other things. You know, there came a point where I really started pushing myself to try to find different ways of solving problems. I wasn't necessarily thinking about elegant solutions, like solutions with fewer steps or that were more efficient. But I was thinking about that this idea that, you know what, if everybody's learning the same math skills, then there's going to be plenty of supply of people who know how to solve problems the standard way. And I thought, if I could become the kind of person, the kind of student who could solve problems sometimes wildly differently than the norm, then there might be problems that other people couldn't solve that I could solve. And there might be maybe higher demand for this kind of person who could solve problems uniquely. So I thought, I'm not really going to add much value to the world. You know, I'm only like 16, 17 years old when I'm thinking this way, but I'm thinking I'm not going to add much value to the world in my life if I learn to solve problems the way everyone else does, because there'll be so many people who can solve those problems. So how am I supposed to be unique? What's my contribution there? I'm just a drone like everybody else. And I didn't want to go that route. And, you know, I think maybe it was, partly the influence of Star Trek, Star Trek The Next Generation, which I think started in 1987, so when I was 16. And that started influencing me to think about, like, you know, what would be my unique contribution if I had to find my own place in the world? Would I be the captain, the chief engineer, you know, that sort of thing? And everybody in the crew had these unique skills that combined together in different ways. They weren't replaceable. And so that, I think, was another influence that got me thinking along these lines. And that turned out to be a really positive progression. And throughout my life, I kept getting rewarded for this idea of finding different ways of solving problems. And it got to the point where sometimes I would just automatically reject the standard solution and look for something else, figuring that I would learn a lot more by exploring more of the solution space. And the solution space is like the set of all possible solutions to a problem. And the problem is, well, you know, an issue is that when we solve problems using the standard textbook methods all the time, we end up with a very narrow exploration of the solution space. So, you know, the solution space might be this vast area of all these different ways we could solve the problem. And we're just like over here in one corner, just all exploring on our, you know, only learning these little, you know, piddly ways of solving the problem. And there's so many other possibilities out there. And I think that becomes a mindset after a while, that we expect that solutions will be given to us, that the standard solution will work. And I think also TV shows tend to give us that mindset, especially TV shows, you know, I grew up watching in the 80s, where every obstacle, you know, has a solution. Every bad guy can be defeated. You know, shows like Knight Rider, The A-Team, Star Trek itself, definitely to some extent, you know, every episode ending with a solution to the problem. No matter how difficult or tricky it was, there was always a solution. At least what I liked about Star Trek is that they often didn't come up with the standard solution. They didn't use the standard solution every time. It wasn't like every episode was the same formula, unlike, say, the A-Team, where it seemed like it was almost like the same episode over and over again. They'd just, like, shoot their guns in the air, and that would be how they'd solve it. Or they'd, you know, weld something together, and that would be it. I guess another show that influenced me was MacGyver, you know, how he would always come up with these creative things using like physics or chemistry, you know, to get himself out of situations. But it's, you know, it's, those shows still had this emphasis that that every problem had a solution. And the truth is that in life, you know, not every problem has a solution. And, you know, some problems are really difficult to solve, especially if you go the standard way. And when you get influenced so much by being in that drone mindset of solving problems the same way everyone else does, I think it's incredibly limiting, especially when you have to solve, you know, problems that aren't as crisp as mathematics or physics, problems that have really blurry edges, and, you know, it's really tough to even define what the problem or challenge is, or to get clear about what the solution will look like. You know, where you have to set your own goals and then find ways to achieve them. That is a really complex solution space. And yet I found that this habit that I got into as a teenager of really exploring more of the solution space and coming up with different ways of solving the same problems that everyone else was facing really served me well later in life. And even during high school, I feel like I got rewarded for this type of behavior again and again and again. I feel really lucky that I went to a Jesuit high school. I'm not a religious person today by any means. I had some issues to go through correcting for 12 years of Catholic school. But, you know, the 4 years of high school I had going to a good Jesuit school, you know, the Jesuits, they tend to think a little differently than most. And I really liked that they encouraged us as students to think for ourselves. And there were a number of teachers there that encouraged me to think differently and to not try to solve every problem the standard way. You know, whether it was like writing a history essay or solving a math problem. You know, I had this one history teacher who would call all of us lobsters and make fun of us if we did what he called just regurgitating the textbook. You know, barfing back the ideas that we were taught in class. We were encouraged a lot to come up with our own ideas, our own interpretations of what was happening when we'd write these history essays. And if our essays looked too much like what was in the textbook, we could be downgraded for that. So we had to think more originally and critically. That again is something that served me well later in life, is this idea of thinking critically and not taking the standard solution. And you can take that too far, I'll definitely say. There's been some times where I've gone way too far with that and rejected the standard solution out of hand and then made things way more complicated than necessary. So I'm not saying that society's solution or the popular solution is always wrong. But, you know, more often than not, I tend to find myself disagreeing with it. Take, for example, how about diet? You know, how do, like most people in the USA, eat? The standard American diet, you know, it's high in fat, high in salt, high in sugar. It's basically pure crap. It's certainly not something that makes people healthy. 90% of the people in this country are going to die from heart disease or cancer. That's a pretty sad realization, you know. And, you know, people dying from alcohol and drugs and, car accidents when they're under the influence, just having, you know, terrible decline in health, in their senior years, losing functionality. And I'm thinking, okay, the standard solution for how to feed ourselves doesn't seem very intelligent to me. So, you know, even when I was in college, I started going vegetarian and vegan after that, and that's been a much better path, especially mentally. Like, the mental clarity, the emotional awareness has been beautiful. Exploring raw foods has been great as well. So that's, you know, going far away from the standard American diet, like back in, the, you know, down in this bottom cruddy corner of the solution space, and going to explore elsewhere, going to look, you know, for solutions in other places. Instead of McDonald's, you go look in nature and find, better, healthier solutions there. And, another example, like in income generation, how do I pay for my life, essentially? How do I buy things? How do I participate in the economy? How do I pay my bills? The standard solution is get a job. Well, I did that. I only had one job in my life, working for $6 an hour at a video game store. And, you know, I did that for several months when I was in college. And after that, I just decided, you know, that doesn't seem like a very good solution. So much more of your money goes to taxes when you're an employee. You can't deduct all these kinds of expenses. You can easily deduct when you're an entrepreneur or run a business. So after that, I became an independent contractor, and I did some contract work for a while as a programmer. And I liked that. That was cool. It was way more lucrative. I went from earning like $6 an hour to, say, equivalent of what I was earning with, because I was getting some straight pay and some royalties. But it worked out to be around $50 an hour I was getting. So that's not bad. And then going from there, starting my own business. And there, I definitely made some screw-ups. See, the thing is, where you explore different parts of the solution space, sometimes you'll come up with a better solution, a more elegant one, and sometimes you'll find something that's actually worse than the standard solution. So for the first 5 years I was in business, I just sank into debt and went bankrupt. And my friends who had jobs, like I had some friends who went to work for a bank. They were working on like programming ATM machines, and they were making more money than me and having better lifestyles initially. And then eventually, you know, I caught up and started doing really well too. But my initial solution took me a lot longer to figure it out than if I just had a job. So there's a lot of a lot of different possibilities in exploring solution spaces. And sometimes, you know, what seems like a bad solution initially may turn into a good one later on, because with certain solutions, you need to upgrade and develop your skills to really be able to apply and to live in alignment with that solution, like running a business or shifting a career in a different direction. You know, you may have to, you know, do some more education and refine your skills to be able to harvest that solution properly. What else? Relationships. So what's the standard solution for relationships? The standard solution, I would say, you know, I've done quite a bit of research on this too, because I've done a lot of speaking at dating conferences. The standard relationship model is actually monogamy plus cheating on the side. That is the most popular relationship model, at least in the USA. Most of the relationships are ostensibly monogamous on the surface, but most of them also include cheating on the side. And either by one or by both partners, at least at some point during the relationship. So I thought, that's an interesting model. I never applied that particular model myself. I applied perhaps what is, you know, the next most popular one, which is monogamy without the cheating. So there's that too. And then another really popular relationship model is no relationship, at least no romantic relationship. In other words, being alone. Those are the most popular standard solutions out there to a romantic relationship. You could say maybe the problem is, like, you don't want to be lonely, or overcoming loneliness, or creating companionship, or having someone to share intimacy with, or having someone to have sex with. The combination of all those things, really. Or if you want to have a family, then having somebody to have kids with. I delved into that model. I was married for many years and eventually separated in 2009 and got a divorce. And my current relationship has been a very different model, a very different corner of the solution space. It's been a long-distance relationship, since my girlfriend Rochelle is Canadian. So we're from different countries, and we travel a lot together. You know, sometimes she's here in the USA, sometimes I'm in Canada, and other times we're just, you know, traveling together, and other times we're in different cities. Right now, at the time I'm recording this, we're in different cities. And another piece to that is we're in an open relationship, and that's been interesting too. So, you know, we can play with other people together, or we can play with other people when we're in different cities. And we define the boundaries in our relationship very differently than others. Jealousy is just not a part of it. I think jealousy is just lame and a waste of time. I trust Rochelle, and I think if our relationship is strong enough, then she should be fine connecting with other people on the side occasionally, and me too. We've been doing that for 7 years now, and it's working beautifully for us. It's an interesting solution, though. It's very different than the norm. But the interesting thing is that I know other people who follow a similar path to what we're doing, and this is where I learned this model from other people, and they seem to be some of the happiest people I know. Generally a lot happier on average than people in some of the other relationship models. Now, I find people who are happy in all kinds of relationship models. I'm not suggesting that anybody needs to copy my solution, because the solution to any of these lifestyle issues is very personal. And you have to look to your strengths, to your desires, your needs, what you want there, and craft a solution that really works for you. The main lesson I want to share here is that, it's so easy to get caught up in a single solution, a single corner of the solution space, and not explore enough of it. I think something that helps you find elegant solutions, if you want to know how to actually find a solution that's better, is that you have to explore more of the solution space. You have to let go to that clinginess to being in your comfort zone, and you have to get used to exploring more and more outside your comfort zone. As an example, when I started blogging, I didn't really know how I was going to generate income from it. I thought, eventually, I'll generate income from this medium, but I didn't know exactly how to do it. So I experimented a lot. In the beginning, I experimented with the Amazon affiliate program. I had donations. People could do donations through PayPal. I got into doing joint venture deals. I did some paid speaking. I did a book deal. I got into doing workshops. I did some one-on-one coaching. And I had advertising on the site for several years in the beginning. And some of it through Google AdSense or other ad services, and some of it that I sold directly to people, creating ad packages and things like that. I mean, they're like, you know, now I'm doing a, you know, different kind of income model, you know, starting Conscious Growth Club. So there's been, you know, I'm sure I'm forgetting some. There's probably been, you know, around a dozen different income streams I've created through blogging. And that allowed me to explore more of the solution space. And it allowed me to see the strengths and weaknesses of each type of solution. For instance, when I did advertising, what I liked about it is that it was very passive. Like, I didn't have to do anything hardly to do the ads, especially the Google AdSense ads. You just put the code on your site, you optimize it a bit. That took me a few months over time, you know, gradually tweaking it so it was doing well. And then I was making like maybe $9,000 a month just from that, and then maybe another $4,000 a month just from other, you know, from other types of advertising, some of which were really passive. And even when I sold the advertising myself, it would be like, you know, a 3-month package or a 6-month package. So you do the sale, get some money by PayPal, and you just let it sit on the site for months. So it was pretty darn passive, even though you might have a little bit of interaction, you know, when you're doing the sale, or maybe you ask for the renewal afterwards. And that for me was a pretty good solution at the time, but I wouldn't say it was an elegant one because it didn't really satisfy all the things I wanted from an income stream. I liked that it was passive. I liked that it was easy. I liked that it was relatively abundant at the time. But what I didn't like is that it put all this clutter on my website, like, you know, having all these ads for things. And some of them I just objected to. Like, as soon as I saw McDonald's ads popping up on my site, I was like, screw that, ban them. So I immediately took that out. The problem is with these, you know, massive ad services, they're geo-targeted. So different people in different cities or different countries are going to see different ads. So I didn't even know what all the ads were. And there were thousands and thousands of different ads displaying on all the different pages of my site, different ads for different people. So I just didn't have control over, you know, what was being shown on my site. Now, for some people, you know, they would define this as like a branding issue, like these ads might be not good for your brand. I honestly just don't think in terms of branding. And in fact, I think I wrote an article years ago called Branding is Fear-Based BS. I just don't think in that whole branding mindset. I really don't care what my brand is. I'm a person, I'm not a brand. And so, you know, with the ads, what really bothered me wasn't the branding aspect. It was that I didn't like the idea of showing these types of advertisements to my visitors, you know, things that might not align with the type of conscious growth I wanted to teach people. And I felt bad, like people might be clicking on these ads and going to some other site and might be a little bit shady. And, you know, I'm not sure how it's going to deal with the people in my audience. I care a lot about these people. I meet them in person. You know, my girlfriend herself is somebody I met at one of my workshops. So I felt kind of protective of them. And so I needed, you know, in 2008, I basically said, screw it, I'm taking all these ads off the site, and just pulled the plug on it and didn't have a way of replacing that income. I had some other income streams at the time, but, you know, it hurt financially, of course. But I knew from experience, you know, especially experience I had back in high school, that if I want to find a really elegant solution, I often have to reject a so-so solution. And I have to say no to the mediocre in order to find something that feels really good and really congruent and that is truly elegant. In other words, I had to reject, you know, that standard solution or the popular solution in order to find one that was really me. And the following year after I moved the ads, I started doing workshops. And that turned out to be not passive income, but it was probably my favorite income stream that I've created to date. I loved it because it was a direct sale. I would make like a $500 sale to each person, and it was a direct sale. And I felt like this is like very fair. It's very honest. I'm just, you know, selling this beautiful experience to people who will come to Las Vegas and do these workshops, and you know they're going to have a wonderful weekend together. And I just thought, this is you know, the way I designed these things, I thought it's a great value for the money, and people were giving them great reviews. And you know, as we did these several times, I was just seeing all the wonderful ripples that were created by it. So I was like, oh, that's, you know, that income stream just lights up my heart. And that one felt way more congruent. Was it an elegant solution? I'd say it was definitely way higher than the advertising, and but it was not, you know, not quite what I was looking for, because I always had to be doing another workshop. And now with Conscious Growth Club, I feel like that's an even more elegant solution. So that's a 1-year coaching program. And it's not really passive income per se, because I'll be doing a lot with it, but I'm doing the work that I love anyway. So I don't mind that so much. And that gives me more flexibility, because now I don't have to schedule a live event and deal with all the logistics and the booking and so on, which can be kind of, you know, difficult. Even though I have a workshop coordinator helping me with that, it does put a lot of extra work on my plate. And it's like this one event in time and space. Whereas with an ongoing coaching program or coaching club, then people can connect over the internet. It's 24/7, and I can do it from, you know, the flexibility of my home, or I can connect with it while I'm traveling. I can record videos in my home like I'm doing now, or I can record videos for it while I'm traveling. You know, I can connect with the forums anywhere. I can do the live coaching sessions from anywhere. So that, to me, is a more elegant solution. So, you know, I want you to see here it's really important if you want to optimize your lifestyle overall, you know, your income streams, the way your relationship works, your diet and your health habits and so on. You have to explore, you have to experiment, and you have to keep saying no to the so-so in order to look for that more elegant solution, a solution that is more efficient, that gives you more of what you want for less energy output or fewer resources required. And the more you go in that direction, I think the better your life gets, the easier it gets, the happier it gets, and the more leverage you have, because now you're able to, you know, gain the combined benefit of all these solutions in your life that can operate synergistically, you know, where your health habits are supporting your work habits, which are supporting your income streams, which allows you to, you know, say buy healthier food or have make some upgrades in your life, things like that. So I want to encourage you not to settle. You know, and the worst thing we settle for is, on a scale of 1 to 10, we settle for that 7. 7 is like the worst. And if you're not a 9 or 10, I want you to think that you haven't found your elegant solution yet. You know, if your relationship is not a 9 or 10, you haven't found your elegant solution yet. I would rate my relationship a 10. I love it. It's beautiful. I'd rate my lifestyle maybe like a 9. There's always, you know, room for improvement, but it can, you know, it's great. Income streams, that for me is probably like, you know, an 8 right now, but I think I'm about to make that a 9 or 10. So that's cool too. And, you know, if I'd settled for what I started with or where I ended up several years ago, I wouldn't have been able to get to those 9s or 10s. And I often had to take a step back in order to get there. So I want you to know, I totally understand how difficult it is to leave your comfort zone. It's, you know, those are some of the hardest decisions you have to make when you have to abandon that 7. It sucks. It sucks to have to leave a relationship that's a 7. It sucks to have to leave a job that's a 7. It sucks to have to, you know, drop an income stream that's a 7, or, you know, change a diet that's a 7. Leave a city that you live in that's a 7 for you. But there's no other way, really, to find your solution. It's not going to happen by you massaging that 7 and turning it into the 9 or 10. You often have to get out of that local maximum and explore somewhere else, explore more of the solution space. So please consider adopting the mindset of an explorer and keep going and don't give up until you find your elegant solution. I'll see you tomorrow.